Hello, everyone. Welcome to another capsule of international relations for the Shankar IAS Academy. Today, we will discuss the Group of 20 summit, which was held in Rome last 2 days, 30th and 31st of October. Since Prime Minister Narendra Modi is personally attending this meeting, it attracted more than the usual attention in India. Not only that, this meeting has been held at a very critical time in the history of the world. Just as G20 was formed. G20 was formed after 2007-2008 economic crisis to deal with the very grave situation that arose in the world economy at that particular time. And since then, it has been meeting every year to review the world situation. And they applied some correctives, took some routine decisions, and so on. The difference between G20 and, say, the Security Council is that in G20, everybody is equal. Nobody has a veto power. And therefore, G20 is emerging as some kind of an alternative, an economic alternative to the Security Council, because all the important countries are present there, but they are all on equal status. And also, these 20 countries represent 80% of global GDP, 75% of global trade, and 60% of the population. So it's virtually represent the whole world in terms of GDP, in terms of trade, and in terms of the population. So the present situation, first, of course, the pandemic, second, the pandemic is a world health crisis, and also world economic crisis following the pandemic, and inability of the United Nations to act on it because of China's role as a permanent member who vetoed any suggestion that the UN Security Council should meet. So in these three circumstances, the meeting of the G20 assumed tremendous amount of importance. And when you look at the result, and of course, I should have mentioned climate change. So this is actually the climate change summit just started today. So this took place just before the COP26, Conference of Parties of the Framework Convention on Climate Change, COP26 it is called. And it has a summit segment, 2 days the heads of states are meeting. So in that context, G20 actually became, if we look at the outcome, will look like a rehearsal of COP26. Because most of the time of G20 meeting was devoted to the climate change issue. So virtually every shade of opinion in the United Nations was present there. And therefore the discussion took place basically to prepare for the COP26. And that is the other, in fact, that was the most significant part of the G20 meeting. It also dealt with some other issues like global taxation and private public participation, et cetera, et cetera. But even though we don't have all the details of what happened with the G20, the most prominent part of the decision-making there was on climate change. Because climate change is on the way to changing tracks again. The climate change strategy was developed in 1992 in Rio de Janeiro. Then it changed in 2015 in the Paris Agreement. And now in Glasgow, it is supposed to take another change. We'll come to that a little later. But Italy, which chaired the summit, Italian Prime Minister, said that he was satisfied with the outcome of G20. And then he immediately added that this is only a start. We must not forget that. We must remember that it is only a start, he said. And taking the decisions or the positions taken by the G20, which of course will go now to the COP26, where everybody will be there. The main effort of the United States and partly China was to abandon the Paris formula. Paris formula, as you know, is to or was to make voluntary reduction in greenhouse gases. So every country says how much they can reduce, and then you put it all together, and the temperature should not go up beyond 2 degrees Celsius. And that was the objective of the Paris Agreement. Now people say that even 2 degrees Celsius is too much. It should be 1.5 degrees Celsius. So one decision, technical decision, shall we say, that G20 took was that the effort should be to make sure, commit ourselves to making sure that the global warming should not exceed 1.5 degrees Celsius. This is very hard to accomplish. And therefore, it is only an objective. That is, all our efforts in future should be to making sure that global temperature should not go beyond 1.5 degrees Celsius. And that is a wish, whether it can happen. The suspicion is that it may not happen. But the more pressing thing that, this of course 1.5 is already an objective, but what the United States wanted was to forget about, voluntary reduction of emissions, etc., and go straight forward a net zero carbon situation. When can you do a net carbon situation? And the United States already said by 2030 they'll be able to do that. China has said 2060 they'll be able to do that. And several others have fixed different years. And India is under tremendous pressure, like other developing countries, to declare a year. Because that means by that year, our consumption of energy should peak and then start reducing. And that is when it becomes net zero carbon situation. And so the push in COP26 is to make everybody declare this. And the leadership of the objection to this, or a different approach to this, is India. And the arguments that India is making are the same old arguments we have been making before Rio de Janeiro. And all through these negotiations, we are taking a fundamental position that developing countries need energy to develop. And therefore, it is unfair, unjust for developing countries to ask to reduce greenhouse gas emissions because their emissions are not very high. If you take per capita, an average Indian's emission is 1/4 of an average American's emission. So this is our argument. We have been saying this all through. And therefore, if we have to use environment-friendly technology, we need the technology and the money. If we don't do that, we'll not be able to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions. And nor can we declare a year as net carbon year, net zero. And so this is the argument which India put forward. India, as usual, leading the developing countries of the world in this argument as against developed countries. And that division has been existing all through. In Rio, we came to some kind of a compromise. But the developed countries walked out of it when they refused to sign Kyoto. And so we got Paris. And now they are leaving out Paris also and say, now we start a Glasgow formula. So what happened in the G20 was, since everybody, all opinions are reflected, that's what will probably happen in COP2. They said that we must have a 1.5 degree Celsius only, should be below that. And secondly, we should strive they're not willing to designate a year. They're saying they should strive to find a year in the middle of the century. People are saying 2050, 2060. So all countries must strive to accommodate and find a date which is suitable for them and declare themselves a net carbon, net zero emission country. And so that is the nearest we can go to. But I don't know whether in COP26 they will change it any further. So the position of the developing countries, which India is championing, and so the developing countries' viewpoint was put forward by India, and that has been registered. So whatever discussions that will take place in COP26, and therefore the position that developing countries, particularly India, has put forward is that we must concentrate on the climate goals, what these goals are, and then try to achieve it through financing and developing of green energy for the developing countries. Because developing countries are bound to use fossil fuels, particularly coal. So one of the movements is to avoid using of coal altogether. As you know, India has the largest deposits of coal, and we are very much dependent on it. So unless we develop alternate strategies for energy in a big way, we simply cannot stop using coal. So they are using some techniques like not allowing countries to, the countries which develop industries, etc., on the basis of coal, they discourage it. The developed countries will not invest in coal industry, etc. And China and India are being accused of using too much of coal. So the obligations of the developed countries has been highlighted. Financing for environment-friendly technology and cost of developing new green energy. And again, the argument that we used was the very same one. And I used to be the chief negotiator in Berlin in 1995. The speeches I used to make there is the same speeches that have been made today. Like one of the things that we say is that we have to cut down wasteful consumption. See, the whole world has been depleted of many of its resources because nobody bothered about it during the Industrial Revolution and afterwards. Everybody was consuming, those rich countries were consuming all the energy. And now that the world has been deprived of it, and there is this great calamity comes, they are saying developing countries should not develop, or you should not use coal, you should not use fuel, then how can they develop? So this is the dilemma. So the call was for cutting on wasteful consumption, conspicuous consumption. The phrase used is what the developed countries are using is what is called luxury emissions, while what developing countries need is survival emissions. So the same argument which I used to make, they are still making. So on energy, climate, instead of focusing only on climate goals, the situations of developing countries, various needs of the developing countries must be focused. So that has been presented. How it will be accepted in Glasgow, we don't know. Then G20 identified sustainable and responsible consumption and production. So the developed countries also seem to have agreed to this, along with provision of finance and technology as critical enablers of achieving climate goals. So it's the same old point. The climate goals mean you must enable developing countries to grow. For that, developed countries have to reduce emissions so that there is some more space for developing countries to emit greenhouse gases for their own development. And also it was pointed out, and Prime Minister Modi himself spoke about sustainable lifestyles, the amount of machines they use, amount of energy they consume every day can be reduced. The number of air conditioners could be reduced, number of cars could be reduced. So he stressed the sustainable lifestyles. And they pointed out also that this is one of the sustainable development goals of the United Nations, adopted by the entire UN. So this has to be done. But of course, developed countries will never listen to that because that means their lifestyles have to change. So this energy intensive lifestyle of the developed countries was questioned. And they should invest in the developing countries, where developing countries are improving their livelihoods. In the developing countries, it is the livelihoods that have been improved, but in the developed countries, it is a luxury. And so all these marginal people, marginal farmers, etc., should be helped so that living livelihoods are not destroyed, either by the pandemic or by climate change. So G20 talked about developed countries should not shift the goalposts. You know, every time they say in 92 they said something, 2015 they said something, and now they are shifting the goalposts. You know, an expression relating to football. You know, you play in a ground, and then you get accustomed to it, legal position, and then you suddenly find when you go to the ground, the goalposts have been shifted. Then how do you play there? And so this was said that we should do more for the planet and put the money where their mouths are, the developed countries. So meaningful and effective action has been repeated in many places in the declaration of G20, but there is no concrete action. There has been no agreement on concrete action because emission have to be controlled, and it cannot be controlled only by the developing countries. So there has been a suggestion that coal should be dispensed with, which of course many developing countries will not accept. So they are saying that they will not finance coal projects for power generation. You use nuclear or you use wind energy or solar energy, etc. So if you ask for investments in coal-fired power generation, the developed countries will not cooperate. This is something we know, but we have to carry on. And so at the end of it, they have said that this is the last chance. Glasgow is the last chance for humanity to save itself from damnation. And that is the conclusion. And then they have said about other things like private-public partnership should be encouraged, no time-bound decision on climate change, no commitment to ending domestic coal consumption. So these are some of the, and these were pushed by India for safeguarding the interests of developing countries. So this has been our traditional role, right, from the beginning. So they, in the Paris Agreement, there was a commitment to provide $100 billion to the developing countries. It was not realized. So they recommitted themselves to producing this $100 billion. Nobody knows who will pay it. But there is a commitment, that that commitment was definitely to be renewed. And the G20 recommended that. What will happen in COP26, we don't know. But this is an old commitment. It has not been delivered. So it is natural that they should be accepted. And then on COVID-19, they took some good decisions about vaccine production, greater vaccine equality. Because in many countries, there are problems. Even we have a problem about one of our vaccines not being recognized. So the G20 asked WHO to recognize all possible vaccines. And of course, they cannot do it without trials and so on. But they asked WHO to recognize more vaccines. And more international public and private funding, not only for vaccines, but also for green projects. So there was, as I earlier mentioned, there is a compromise in the G20. As against people who want countries to be identified, I mean, years to be identified as net zero. Now, what G20 says is that stress the key relevance of achieving global net zero on carbon emissions around mid-century. You know, in the UN always, you find a compromise language, which is good for everybody. So We have not committed to a day or a year, but we have said that it is important to find a day and an indication that that could be in the middle of the century. It can be 2050, it can be 2060, even 2070, you can consider it middle of the century. So that is a big compromise of G20 between developed and developing countries. And recognition of more vaccines, etc. And India's position has not changed, as I said from the beginning. So we are asking for climate justice. So we are willing to reduce emissions as far as possible, that we are committed to that. But any kind of forced fixing of date is not acceptable to us. India does not have adequate techniques. In fact, another issue, this was new, that India raised, is a clean energy we can produce, maybe. But it is not enough that you produce clean energy. We must have the grid to hold it. You know what I mean? Because if you provide green energy and if you use it immediately, that's not good for the future. So large amounts of clean energy, even if you produce it, we don't have a grid. And therefore, more money will have to be spent on the grid stability. So clean energy is not as cheap as they think, because the creation of grids will cost money. And that has also been highlighted. So the United Nations Secretary General at the end of the G20 meeting expressed his disappointment that no decision was taken about a particular year when the world will become net zero year. But then he said, my wish has not been buried, and I hope that this will be further discussed in COP26, which has just happened today. So these are the basic climate change decisions or recommendations that G20 has made. Then there are some other subjects which would have been very important if climate change was not in the focus. And that is about money laundering. You know, you may know that there is an organization called Financial Action Task Force, FATF. This was established in 1989. It's a governmental group to combat money laundering and terrorist financing. And this has been watching it and reporting to the world. So as you know, you might have heard that Pakistan is, you know, there is a white list, a gray list, and a black list. So the blacklisted countries are fully accountable. They are responsible for many of these terrorist financing. But Pakistan is not in the black category because they have been fighting it. And so they came into the gray category. And then now they are trying to be in the white category, means they are not doing counter money laundering or terrorist financing. So the G20 decided to strengthen this and also to make sure that the international financial system should not be challenged by these countries. And the latest in the list is Turkey has been recently added to the gray list, because Turkey is supposed to have done some money laundering. So that is another thing that they decided. Then enhanced confidence in the digital environment, because there is always this threat of cyber crimes and cyber attacks, cyber warfare, etc., etc. And also by sheer default, sometimes serious things can happen. You know, a virus can get into your system and destroy the whole system. So it becomes a warfare if you deliberately do it, but sometimes it can happen also by mistake. And so enhanced confidence in the digital environment, because it has several elements, I'm not going into all those details, is one of the things that they have supported. Then zero tolerance for corruption. Corruption, of course, is a major disease of the whole world economy. And in Vienna, when I was there in 2003, the United Nations formulated a convention against corruption, a UN convention against corruption. And that was signed by many countries, etc. But still, corruption is rampant, in particularly in developing countries. Even developed countries are not free from corruption, but mostly developing countries. But developing countries, it's kind of small corruption at the individual level. But in the developed countries, it is at the highest level. Huge corporations, millions of dollars is what you get. So corruption is only a matter of degree, and it's all over the place. And therefore, G20 demanded that there should be zero tolerance on corruption. And one of the points that is always discussed in the cause of corruption is, you commit a corrupt practice somewhere and take the money and put it in a bank in Switzerland. So does Switzerland have any responsibility for this? Because Switzerland can say this money came legally to our bank. They cannot ask where you got this money from. But the governments have been, the concerned governments have been asking for them to return the money. And the most famous case is of the Philippine president, Marcos. Billions of dollars he has stacked up in Geneva banks. And it was all government's money. And the government fought very hard. And finally, the Swiss banks returned the money to Philippines government. There have been other cases also like that. But the responsibility is of that government to prove that it was illegal money. It's not enough that you say that he took away this money without the permission of the government. But how did he earn it in the first instance? Suppose he earned it in a legitimate manner, then can he be punished? Should that money be given to the state? It's a long discussion. I participated in it in Vienna. And so this was also a very important decision. Then the taxation system. You may have heard when G7 met, one of the decisions they took was to make it uniform, the taxation system of big corporates. And they had come to an agreement that it should be only 15%, or at least 15% taxation could be made of international investors. And this has also been reiterated in the sense that G20 has approved this decision, further strengthening the economic regime. So in the first instance, pandemic was dealt with. International cooperation was stressed that all organizations must cooperate to fight this. And vaccine justice, all human beings or anywhere in the world should have the same access to vaccines. Therefore, international cooperation. As you know, in the Quad, there is already an agreement that some countries will have innovation, some countries have money, and some countries have manufacturing capability. The vaccine did not succeed because each one was trying to do things that they don't have. You have innovation, but no money. You have money, but you have no manufacturing capability. So in the new Quad, Israel, India, UAE, United States Quad, which has just been formed, they have said that Israel has innovation, UAE has money, India has capability, and the US will give the kind of umbrella to operate this. And that is the situation as far as Quad is concerned. That's, in other words, international cooperation. That has been stressed. The only problem there was China was not allowing United Nations to take any action because they were afraid that the accusation will come to them. Even the investigation as to where the virus came from has not been completed because China is not giving the right answers or the right data. So in other words, virtually G20 meeting, because of its such close proximity to the COP26, was hijacked by the climate change issue. That is what happened. Because everybody was preoccupied with what to say in COP26. And so they decided to shape some compromises. Otherwise, again, this whole thing will have to be discussed. So my feeling is that COP26, the discussion will start on the basis of some of the agreements reached in G20. And then each country will try to push its position, and finally some kind of a compromise will be made in the COP26. And then we will see that it is inadequate, so we'll have to then go for another climate change plan. So 92 climate change plan, Rio, you can say 1.0, then Paris could be 2.0, and now after Glasgow, 3.0. But in the meantime, ice is melting, sea level is rising, floods are taking place all over the place, droughts, unseasonal rains. So it's quite true that we have ruined the earth, and the earth is striking back. And so this is the time. If you waste the time today, succeeding generations will have no air to breathe or food to eat. And that is a dangerous situation. So we owe it to our next generations to do something when we still are capable of breathing. And of course, pandemic, it is obvious. Then there is the terrorist threat, another thing that they dealt with. Of course, they didn't talk about Chinese threat. China is part of G20. But I'm sure on the sidelines, they must have discussed China, they must have discussed Afghanistan, another hot issue, but not formally. They simply talked about terrorism, which is actually Afghanistan. So on the whole, the discussions have helped to understand the issues. As far as climate change is concerned, the conference of parties will decide. And on other things, G20's recommendations will definitely be respected and implemented by the G20 nations, which, as I said, the big chunk of the world, the whole world is not there, but all the important countries are there, and therefore what they decide and what they do will have an impact on the whole world. So thank you very much. Well, that is, you know, when you talk about climate change, you cannot say temperature should be brought down, full stop, right? Because that kind of capability, every country does not. And the developing countries have a need to increase. So, and that was what was accepted in Rio de Janeiro. They said common but differentiated responsibilities. I've heard that word. Originally, we kept saying main responsibility of developed countries. And they kept saying common responsibility of all countries. Okay. So the final compromise, I still remember in Geneva at 3 o'clock in the morning, somebody said, why not common but differentiated responsibility? That became the mantra or the Bible of the negotiations. And that is what helped in the Rio de Janeiro meeting. But the Western countries have been gradually moving out of that. And they have been saying, your emissions are bigger than our emission. See, 250 million people emitting and 1 billion people emitting cannot be equated, because you have to take it per capita. So there are several elements like that. The fact that developing countries need energy and resources to move forward is one thing. And secondly, the developed countries have to reduce their emissions, so there is some space. You know, there is only enough space, so much space for carbon dioxide in the earth. And that space has to be given to the developing countries. So there are several elements in this. And so climate justice has been used, but Mr. Modi is the one who has given it a great currency. And he has talked about climate justice in the Mahabharata and Rig Veda and all that. He has been saying that. It depends to be, it remains to be seen, because the Quad of 2000, it was started in 2007. You know how many years it took for us to reach here. And basically because India's reluctance to join any military pact. Because Americans have clearly seen it as an anti-Chinese pact. And US, Japan, and Australia had no problem. They're already in a pact against the Chinese. You know, they have a military pact. So India was the only one which was not in a military pact. So we played it down. And the other reason is we have a land border with China. You know, these others can dance around in the ocean and say Chinese threat. But here they are sitting on our borders. So the first attack will be on us, as we have seen before. And therefore, we were not wanting to provoke China. But when this situation happened in 2020, we couldn't help it, and therefore we moved in the direction of that. And then when the AUKUS was formed as a real military machinery, then Quad became independent a little more. And so they will now deal with climate change, with the vaccines and so on. So economically also, and supply chains. So Quad is becoming a more, so people say that the creation of AUKUS, people say AUKUS was a real betrayal, you know, they made another group and all that, that's one view. But the other view is now that the military element has been shifted to somewhere else, Quad will find a role for itself. As far as the so-called Middle East Quad is concerned, that is Israel, India, UAE, and the US. Incidentally, they have also created another quad. I don't know, people seem to have forgotten. They have an America, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Uzbekistan quad also. So I don't know what that logic was. Anyway, that's also there. So this is the third quad. So you can have a quad of quad if you have one more. There'll be four quads. Anyway. First point is India does not want to be in any military alliance. And so we have been dragging our feet. Even now we are much relieved that the AUKUS will take care of that. But in definitely India will need that support if there is a crisis. Suppose China invades India totally, and then we will certainly turn to Quad and ask for help. And it happened during Trump's time. Trump was in fact willing to take on the Chinese on the Indian border. So now the present president is not so keen. And it depends. So OECD is a rich man's club. And they don't have any military aspects to it, except that, of course, they support the NATO. And that can reach their objectives more easily because it's a developed country's club. And they also assist developing countries. So that kind of homogeneity this group does not have. And that is the reason. Why is it that the non-aligned group is not able to accomplish as much as OECD? It is a lack of resources. When the economic crisis came in 2007, at that time the only body there was G7. G7 were all the powerful countries, the richest countries in the world. So they realized that unless you carry the less rich countries, but more powerful in terms of resources, in terms of population, in terms of size, must also be taken into confidence. And that is how it was formed. And it played a very big role. And Dr. Manmohan Singh, as an eminent economist, played a big role in G20. And everybody conceded that G20 can accomplish more things than what the Security Council can do. As I said, because everybody is equal in that. And that is how G20 was formed. But its activities, of course, depends on as much as the members want. You know, the usual thing that we say when you ask about UN. You say UN cannot have the power that people don't give it to them. You know, every member is a sovereign country. Unless you give power to the UN, UN will have no power. And similarly in G20 also. So on many occasions, G20 didn't take any action. In 2020, at the instance of India, G20 called a meeting. Saudi Arabia was the chairman at that time, but nothing came out of it about the pandemic. Some pledges were made, but no concrete help. Now G20 is focused on it. Quad is focused on it. Now United Nations will also focus on it, and therefore international cooperation. And that was the whole purpose of creating G20. Okay, thank you very much.